The Unsung War Casualties, Chapter 2. Sachs continues in his second letter to my sister Marianne. The Red Cross parcel we shared at Christmas was a lifesaver, but not enough to sustain us. Actually, it contained about as many calories as one of us would consume in a three-meal normal day at home. We were both losing weight at an alarming rate, and one day, as I stood in line for our soup ration, I passed out and fell over the bucket that held the soup. You can imagine what a ruckus that caused. They grabbed me and laid me on the floor next to the bucket and continued serving soup to those in line. I came out of it in time to get my little cup of soup, but it wasn't enough to give me much strength. We noticed that everyone around us had lice. We declared that this wouldn't happen to us. We washed our upper bodies with snow frequently. There was no running water, so we used snow for drinking and bathing. But sure enough, both Bernie and I had come down with the cursed lice infection. There was no escape from it. A second problem arose when I began to throw up the soup ration right after drinking it. It was a desperate situation, as we needed every ounce of nourishment we could get. One of the older prisoners said that our vomiting was due to the lack of salt, and that without salt, nothing would stay down. So, I went on a serious search for any salt and tried to buy some from the long-term prisoners, but they went part with what they had, even for cigarettes. Finally, another prisoner came to me with a little pack of what he claimed was salt, but it was red in color. I tried it, and it tasted salty, so I bought it for a couple of cigarettes, and that bartering taking place within the camps. It seemed to help for a couple of days until I learned that the prisoner who had sold it to me had scraped it out of the bottom of one of the air raid fire barrels that stood around camp. It was a form of sodium, not salt, that the Germans, it's another name for the Germans, would put in the water to help smother fires during air raids. I stopped using it since I feared it might be poison. I continued to plan for an escape, but was getting weaker each day, and it was becoming more difficult to believe that I could survive long enough to reach an airport, even if I got out of the camp okay. Of course, I never trusted the confidence man or escape committee again after my first experience with them. I'm convinced that they had sold out to the Jerrys, the Germans, after their long imprisonment and were being used to keep us new prisoners in line. As January progressed, the days became colder and the nights were brutal. A cold, frosty fog hung in the barracks and the temperature hovered around zero inside. We stayed alive by snuggling tightly against each other. We would coordinate turning over so that as little cold air as possible would get in between us. I'll show a picture of the prisoners and what they would try to do. Again, they'd be so close like that. Again, the ribs sticking out, but it was so cold in those barracks that they had to be close to try to share body warmth like that. It's amazing what people will do just to survive. In late January, another parcel was handed out, but this time it was one for each four prisoners. Bernie and I teamed up with a nice kid named Wright, James or Dave, I think, and Frank Rapetti, one of my former bunkmates. Dividing the parcel was difficult, as we had to split the powdered milk and other foods into two parts. Containers were in short supply, and it took a lot of doing to divide everything up. The four of us remained friends until our rescue. So, Wright and Rapetti are introduced into the story. We began to hear the rumble of artillery each day, and at night, we could sometimes see the red glow in the eastern sky. Each day, the sound of artillery became louder, and we knew that the Russians were coming closer. One day, Bernie and I decided to go for broke, and we mixed up all our remaining food from the parcels into a kind of dough, and we cooked it on a plate, actually a can lid. We ate it down, and it tasted wonderful. Actually, it probably would taste awful to us under ordinary circumstances, but anything edible tasted wonderful to us, and we ate every scrap of it. But within hours, we were both deathly sick and thought we might die. We discovered that the can lid we had used for a cooking surface was actually a paint can lid, which was covered with lead paint. We both had a bad dose of lead poisoning. It made everything worse because we couldn't even get down the daily soup or bread ration for about a week or 10 days. It was a miracle that we recovered. By this time, Bernie and I had saved up 10 or 20 packs of cigarettes by the smuggling of potatoes earlier and making blowers for the other prisoners. We felt that we were rich, as whatever there was to be bought in the camp could only be bought with cigarettes. Money was no good, and D-bars were no good, just cigarettes. Even the Germans could be corrupted with cigarettes. But around the end of January 1945, or early February, the Russians were getting really close, and we expected them to overrun our camp any day. We could hear the sounds of fighting all the time. Again, the Russians are technically on our side, but we're going to find out that we couldn't really trust that they were going to be friendly to our prisoners. The Germans lined us up and were preparing to march us out to the west. I had thought of hiding out in the ceiling areas of the barracks to wait for the Russians, who presumably were our allies. But the Jerry started a rumor that the Russians had declared war on the United States. And from what we knew of the Russians, that was not entirely improbable. Bernie convinced me that we should get out to the west and not take a chance that the Russians would be friendly. And so it was that we lined up with 5,000 other Americans and another 5,000 Russian, French, and English prisoners and began what would become a 2-month death march back to Berlin, which is a city in Germany. The order of formation was 5 prisoners abreast with a German guard on each side. The column extended for a couple of miles as we started the long, cold walk. We moved day and night. No rations of any kind were given to us for the entire march, and we survived only by what we had in our pockets and what we could scrounge by slipping out of line to grab from the fields. The farmers kept mounds of horse turnips at the ends of each field. These were covered with earth dirt to protect them from the cold. We would sometimes dash out of line and quickly dig into the mounds and come up with a horse turnip, which we would share among the 4 of us, Wright, Rapetti, Southerton, and me. I want to show you a little bit about this death march. Here you can see one image of prisoners being marched, guards on each side. Another image, a drawing. Sometimes the prisoners didn't make it, they would collapse. Another image. We'll see more of this coming up. See, maybe gone all the way back there, what Sachs had described. So they were fleeing from the advancing Russian military, and this was something that, again, took place. It's famous, and this death march was sort of an escape plan for everybody to avoid being harmed or killed by the Russians, who were very, very aggressive in the war at this time. I will continue. Some of the guards permitted this when their officers weren't near. Sometimes officers rode us down on horseback, and many were shot before they could get back into the column. One day, a particularly nasty horseman rode me down and fired shots at me before I could disappear back into the ranks. That same day, I came upon the body of a dead prisoner as I walked along the ranks. It was Carl Johnson, the kind and handsome redhead, who had saved my life earlier as I crossed under the fence from the Czech compound. Carl had a neat black hole in the middle of his forehead. I will never forget the grief and anger that I felt at that time. This is, looks like a watercolor or an image. Potentially, this is something that maybe Carl had to face at the end of his life. Again, prisoners have, even though they're desperate, they still have hope that they're going to survive and still have hope that they're going to be rescued. They still have hope that the end of the war is near. And they got to know each other. Sachs, of course, knew of Carl Johnson. And Carl Johnson saved Sachs's life. So you can imagine the grief that Sachs felt. I'll read that last line again. I will never forget the grief and anger that I felt at that time. What a terrible situation for Sachs in particular. A terrible thing for him to witness. I do have a question at the bottom. Something that maybe we can talk about in small groups or as a class. Why did Sachs and Sully initially collect cigarettes in camp when neither of them smoked? Give at least two reasons from the text to support your answer. Include an introduction answering the question, as well as a conclusion at the end, paraphrasing your introduction. Whether we write about it or talk about it, I do want you to think about that as we end chapter 2 and get ready for chapter 3 in our next video.